stresses due to internal pressure in pipe and wall thickness calculation. So this is the next topic. Let us consider an internally pressurized cylinder with thickness T in a radius Ri, outer radius R0, and mean radius Rm. Now let the internal pressure of the cylinder be P. This analysis is limited to thin walled pressure pipe. For a cylinder to qualify as thin walled, the ratio of the radius to thickness, that is Ri by T, must be at least 10. That is, Ri by T should be greater than or equal to 10. The inner portion of the pressurized pipe is exposed to the same pressure in all the directions. The pressure force acts in the normal direction to the surface. Due to this, the pipe wall is stretched in all directions. The walls of the pressurized pipe generally undergo triaxial loading. From the symmetry of the circular cross-section, there are two principal stresses, axial and circumferential in general. It is developed uniformly along the circumference of the pipe wall. The stress in the axial direction is called longitudinal pressure stress. Stresses in the circumferential direction is called the hoop stress. And stresses towards or away from the central axis of the pipe is called radial stress. The radial stress for a pipe is equal and opposite to the gauge pressure on the inside surface and zero on the outside surface. The circumferential stress and the longitudinal stresses are usually much larger for the pressure vessels, and so for thin walled instances the radial stress is usually neglected. So we have primarily two pressure stresses left, and that is axial and circumferential. However, we will be seeing all the three stresses forms. Now, we will starting with a discussion on longitudinal stresses. When analyzing thin walled pressure pipe, it is assumed that all the stresses act parallel to the surface of the pipe. In the pressurized cylinder above, let a cut be made by slicing the cylinder in vertical direction. In order to satisfy equilibrium for this free body diagram, there must be some force which counteracts the internal pressure. Now, the only stresses acting on the cut which counteracts the internal pressure is the normal stress SL, and that will be the longitudinal stress. So, we have the internal pressure P for the pressurized fluid contained within the pipe or flowing within the pipe, and to counteract this pressure P, we will have a normal stress SL in order to make the system in equilibrium. So we have a longitudinal stresses SL along the thickness of the pipe. So, P force is acting in the flow area of the pipe, whereas the SL, the stress, the longitudinal stresses, they are developed along the thickness of the pipe. At this point, we have enough information to apply force equilibrium in the longitudinal direction. The figure above represents the fact that the force caused by the internal pressure must be equilibrated by the force caused by the longitudinal normal stress. Now, the area of the flow is pi Ri square, and the area of the thin strip the thickness is par r naught square minus of pi r I square. The area acted on by the longitudinal stresses and the pressure stresses are calculated in the figure above. as stresses, and pressure is expressed in unit of force over area to include stresses force and the pressure force in force equilibrium equation, one must multiply these stresses and pressure with the area on which it acts. So we have area for the thin metallic portion of the thickness T is pi r naught square minus of pi r I square, r naught being the outer radius and r I being the inner radius, and thus the longitudinal stresses, and as the longitudinal stresses are SL, the stress force on this area is pi r naught square minus of pi r I square the whole into SL, that is area multiplied by stresses gives the stress force, and this stress force needs to be equal in order to have the equilibrium condition satisfied with the pressure force. And in the flow region we have a area of pi r I square, and internal pressure as P has already been defined, so the pressure force equals to pi r I square into P. Therefore, when we equilibrium both of these, we have the longitudinal stresses as, in order to be cylinder stationary, stress forces balances the pressure force, and thus pi I square P in equals to pi r naught square minus of pi r I square into SL, and the longitudinal stresses turns out to be the ratio of the pressure force divided by the area of the metallic cross section with a thickness T. Here the equation can be rearranged by factorizing the denominator portion, wherein r naught square minus of r I square can be written as r naught plus r I into r naught minus of r I in the form of a plus b a minus b, and this becomes pi r I square into p divided by pi 2 r m into t, where r naught minus of r I equals to the thickness t and r naught plus r I equals to twice of the mean radius. So from previous equation we have SL equals to r I square into p divided by 2 r m into t when we cancel out pi, and in order to make this equation more simplified, as we have in numerator the inner radius and in denominator we have the mean radius, what we have in the equation is a less than if we consider the inner radius approximately equal to the mean radius. So the longitudinal stresses developed can be rearranged to written in the form of rm into p by 2t, and which again can be further simplified and can be written as r naught into p by 2t if it is a thin walled pipe, and obviously the longitudinal stresses are lesser, means to say the exactly longitudinal stresses for the thin walled pressure pipe will be r I square into p divided by 2 r m into t. Now, in order to simplify all our calculations, we make the radius same in order to cancel out the equal terms, and then we are left with the mean diameter into p by 2t, which again can, in order to simplify the equation, we have based on the outer radius, we have it in form of r naught into p by 2t. Thus, the longitudinal stresses is always is r naught into p by 2t, which is the maximum radius taken. Above set of equations represents several variations of the formula that might appear in different articles on the subject. The first expression is the most accurate one, whereas the last expression r naught p by 2t is the most conservative one, yielding the highest stress. Due to longitudinal stresses, also called the axial stresses, pipe splits up along its circumference as shown. So, if this pressure is too high, then the pipe will split up along the circumference, that is a vertical split will be made, and there will be failure in the pipe leading to the damage. Image for the longitude node of the axial failure in pipe is shown. Next, having derived the equation for the longitudinal stresses, we will be deriving the equation for the hoop stress. Here, the same pressure P also exerts a force in a diametrical direction. This time, we will look at the pressure acting on the element in a vertical direction. So, this time, we will cut or split the thin-walled cylinder, thin-walled pipe, along its diameter, and then we will look at the projected area. The internal pressure P again acting as it was in the earlier case, and in order to mitigate this internal pressure, we have a hoop stress again along the pipe thickness. As we have drawn in the pressure, as we have drawn, it is the pressure again which is trying to inflate the element. Here we are focusing on forces which acts in a vertical direction. The only stresses acting in the vertical direction which can counteract the pressure shown on the previous page is the normal stress SH. This stress in this case, this stress is called the hoop stress. Now, calculating the forces in the elemental area of the cross section shown below, we will be taking the projected area along the diameter of the pipe. So, pressure P is acting on the projected area. Projected area is having an elemental length L, and the radius of the inside of the pipe is RI. So, acting along the diameter 2RI, the pressure force on this projected area is projected area into pressure, which equals to 2RI into elemental length L into P. Now, along pipe wall thickness with elemental length L, we have the hoop stresses acting in order to equilibrium this pressure force, equilibrate this pressure force. So stress force equals to 2L into T into SH. So again, L being the elemental length and T being the thickness of the pipe. On equating both the forces, we have 2RI into L into P, which is equals to 2L into T into SH, or hoop stress is equals to RI by T into P, P being the pressure, T being the thickness. The previous relation assumes a uniform hoop stress across the thickness. In reality, the stress is not uniform and is greater near the inside surface. In the diametrical direction, the stress is higher at the inner surface and lower at the outer surface. To compensate for this non-uniform stress distribution, the design equation normally uses the outside radius instead of the inside radius as SH equals to R0 by T into P. And by again making SH the hoop stresses in the form of R0, that is the outer radius, we can relate it with the longitudinal stresses which was derived earlier. As now we have seen that longitudinal stresses was approximately equal to Rm into P by 2T, and which was less than R0 into P by 2T, and hoop stresses equals to R0 into P by T, it is clear that the hoop pressure stress is roughly twice the value of the longitudinal pressure stress. So it depends on how we calculate and which radius to take into consideration. So hoop stress is not exactly equal to the longitudinal pressure stress practically, but it is roughly twice the value of the longitudinal pressure stress. However, for the for calculation purpose, if one makes the basis of radius is the outer diameter, the base of the radius being inner diameter, or the mean radius in fact, we can have this relation written in the form as longitudinal stresses equals half of that of the hoop stresses, but exactly it is not equal. It is roughly equal to half of the hoop stress. Next, we will be discussing on radial stresses. Radial stress SR is the third normal stress present in the pipe wall. It acts in the third orthogonal direction, that is parallel to the pipe radius. Radial stress, which is caused by the internal pressure, varies between a stress equal to the internal pressure at the pipe's inner surface and a stress equal to the atmospheric pressure at the pipe's external surface. So, in order to satisfy the equilibrium condition here, the radial pressure will be equal to the atmospheric pressure, which is equal to the outside pressure. So, this pressure is totally present to equilibrate the outside atmospheric pressure. Now, if the pressurized pipe is in the form of the jacketed pipe, the outside pressure will not be atmospheric. In that case, the outside pressure will be the fluid pressure that is contained within the jacket of the pipe. So, this radial pressure is always in equilibrium with the outside pressure, and assuming that there is no external pressure, radial stresses may be calculated as SR equals to P RI square minus of R naught, RI square R naught square by RM square, where RM is the mean radius, and the whole divided by R naught square minus of RI square. The radial stress is zero at the outer radius of the pipe, where bending stresses are maximized. For this reason, this stress component has traditionally been ignored during the stress calculations, and the values of these radial stresses are very much less than compared to the value of the axial and the hoop stresses, because it just has to, because it's just equal to the pressure force of the outside acting on the outer diameter of the pipe. If the pressure force is atmospheric, then the radial stresses will be atmospheric, and if it is, as said earlier, for the fluid contained in the jacketed pipe, it will be equal to the fluid pressure that's present in the jacket. Now, having calculated two prominent stresses types created by fluid contained in thin wall cylinder, we advance forward to see how these stresses govern pipe wall thickness calculation. The wall thickness of pipe on almost all occasions is selected based on thickness required for the internal pressure and allowances. After the two pressure forces seen above, hoop stress as such is used for pipe wall thickness calculation, and the piping is then supported sufficiently such that the longitudinal, that is the axial stress, is within the limits of the required codes, and the deflections also remain within acceptable limits. If the thickness calculation of the pipe would have been done on the basis of longitudinal stress, just for the sake of imagination, then that thickness would fall short to contain the simultaneously generated hoop stress, as it is roughly twice the longitudinal stress, and the pipe would fail circumferentially. The major stress acting on the pipe in sustained condition are due to pressure. We have longitudinal stresses and hoop stresses. Due to weight, we have axial stresses, bending stresses, and torsion shear stress. The pressure stress and the shear stresses are considered roughly uniform around the pipe circumference, whereas the bending stress varies around the circumference. Interestingly, location and sign of maximum and minimum bending stress govern to much an extent the stress requirements for calculation of sustained stresses. with two-dimensional stress intensity formulation and sign convention, it can be easily established that the combined stress intensity primarily contains the sum of longitudinal pressure stress and the weight bending stress. Combination of longitudinal stress and hoop stress is not required. This, when pipe is designed for hoop stress, at least one half of the strength in the longitudinal direction, assuming that the pressure in pipe is sufficient enough that entire longitudinal stress is mitigated, remains still available for weight and other sustained loads to cater for bending, torsion and shear stresses, that is the other form of the weight stresses. As the bending, torsion and shear stress are weight generated stresses, even if they tend to be tremendously high, that leftover thickness is not sufficient enough to provide the required strength, these can at any times be easily controlled by the proper supporting and weight distributions. So these totally being the external stresses can be at any time be controlled by supporting the pipe properly. So calculations of thickness required for a straight pipe is the first step towards the pressure design of all the components. Pipe thickness is selected in three steps. Now we will be calculating the thickness of the pipe, and we have just seen how pressure governs the thickness calculation of the pipe, as the weight stresses generally can be easily balanced out by proper supporting, and we have the enough stresses left while we have done the hoop stresses in order to account for the weight stress. So now moving on to the pipe thickness calculation. The pipe thickness is selected in three steps. First one being, from the design pressure, the minimum required net thickness is calculated. Then the net thickness is added with allowances such as corrosion and erosion allowance, shred allowance and manufacturing under tolerance to become the minimum nominal thickness. So initially the net thickness is calculated, and then we have to calculate we have to add some certain allowances to it in order to get the minimum nominal thickness. And finally, the final step is to select a commercially available nominal thickness that provides the minimum required nominal thickness. Now let us discuss the first step, that is the calculation of the minimum required net thickness from the design pressure. As it's seen above, calculation of pressure stresses were simple for the thin wall cylinders due to the reasonably small thickness. But as the thickness increases, the variation of pressure stress is seen significantly. For wide range of diameter to thickness ratio, Lamy's provided an equation for thickness calculation. What we have derived, the hoop stress for the thin walled pipe was limited for the diameter to thickness ratio for the thin walled. Well, Lamy's provided an equation that is catered to the wide range of thickness to diameter ratio, the diameter thickness ratio. So the Lamy's equation is in the form of P and D by T. So P is multiplied with D by T in a particular order, and thus the hoop stress is calculated, and this hoop stress calculation is valid for wide range of diameter to thickness ratio. This equation, though being accurate, is complex in nature to be readily applied in day-to-day engineering. The piping code ASME B31.3 has given a design formula that properly takes into account the non-uniform stress distribution discussed above without getting involved in much complexity. So if we take this Lamy's equation and calculate thickness, the calculation would be a bit complex, and we need a simple equations in order to proceed for all the practical day-to-day calculations. So B31.3 has provided an equation which is at par in terms of the results with the Lamy's equation, and it's not again being too complex. The equation provided by the process piping code for thickness calculation is the empirical Brodmann equations with simple rearrangement and introduction of longitudinal joint efficiency or quality factor. It provides a good match to the more accurate and Lamy's equation. So the minimum required net thickness for a straight pipe under internal pressure for T less than D by 6 provided in piping pressure piping process piping code ASME P31.3 is T equals to PD by 2SEW plus PY, where P is the internal design gauge pressure, D equals to the outer diameter of the pipe, S equals to stress value of the material, E is the longitudinal joint efficiency or quality factor, W equals to weld joint strength reduction factor, and Y is the coefficient values. So this equation is the rearrangement of the Brodmann equation, which though have no formal base but is equal in providing the results as that with the Lamy's equation, and it being very much simple when compared with the Lamy's complex equation. The values of SEWY are listed in code in the tabular form. So these are the factors SEWY, and they are listed in the tabular form in the code. So these can be looked upon, the values for it can be looked upon, and when the entire design gauge pressure and outside diameter of the pipe is given, one can calculate the thickness required. Earlier, the factor W, that is weld joint reduction factor, was not included into the process piping code B31.3. Onwards 2004's code equation, it is defined as the ratio of nominal stress to cause failure of the weld joint to that of the base material for the same duration. Code explains the requirement of this factor as: at elevated temperatures, the long-term strength of the weld joint may be lower than the short-term strength of the base material. So code emphasizes for longitudinal or spiral, that is a helical seam welded piping components, the product of the allowable stress and the applicable weld quality factor SE shall be multiplied by the weld joint reduction factor W when determining the required wall thickness for internal pressure in accordance with para 304 of the code. Once we have calculated the net thickness, we will be calculating the minimum nominal thickness. So this is the second step, that is wherein we are going to add up the allowances over the calculated net thickness in the first step. What we just calculated above was thickness requirement of the pipe in case it experiences a design pressure. Theoretically, by this first step alone, the pipe is capable of withstanding the design pressure without any failure. But what about the factors that after long service of pipe starts getting corroded or eroded? Even before it's put into service, what if for threaded components grooves are to be cut? What again if during manufacturing itself, at some portion of the pipe thickness calculated above get varied? To meet all these and other such sort of practical aspects which the pipe may see during its long service after it is manufactured, process piping code B31.3 provide an equation wherein all such mechanical allowances needs to be added to the net pressure thickness calculation in the first step. That is what we have just calculated. As per the code, the net required minimum thickness here equals to net thickness plus C, where C equals the sum of the mechanical corrosion and erosion allowances. Now we have the third and final step, that is to select a commercially available nominal thickness that pipe provides. This minimum required nominal thickness Now the minimum required nominal thickness calculated in second step can be any number with infinite decimal points. So, is it that for every thickness calculated in step 2, pipe manufacturing company will start producing pipes? Obviously, this is not the desired thing which any manufacturer will want and need to keep on praying for their clients turning up with similar thicknesses, if not exact. So, it's not that key for every thickness the manufacturer will produce a particular pipe. So, obviously, that's going to make the work a lot more tougher. To take up with this problem, nominal thickness are standardized. In the US, these thicknesses are also represented by weight grades as standard, extra strong, and double extra strong, and by schedule numbers ranging from schedule 10 to schedule 160. Stainless steel pipes have separate schedule numbers appended with letter S, such as schedule 5S, schedule 10S, etc. So, the manufacturer is not capable of and should not produce all the thicknesses variation of the thicknesses required for various number of design conditions for the pipe by the various number of clients. So, there is a practice of standardization of the nominal thicknesses that the pipe manufacturer will be producing, and what we have to see is that the thickness for which we have arrived at in step 1st and step 2nd taken together should match with the standard available thickness that is present in the market. Thus, the thickness calculated in step 2 is matched with the next available standardized nominal thickness available in industry. Now, there is an interesting aspect associated with the pipe OD. For the diameter greater than or equal to 14 inches and for the diameter less than 14 inches. For pipes with a diameter less than 14 inches, we have the OD value fixed and the inner ID value, that is the inner diameter of the pipe, varies as per the thickness. So, the outer diameter being fixed, the inner diameter varies as per the available thickness, as per the thickness calculation. Now, it is interesting to see that 1 inch pipe has nothing of size 1 inch, that is 25.4 mm. That is, neither its inner diameter ID is exactly equal to 1 inch, nor its outer diameter OD is of 1 inch. Instead, OD is 33.4 mm and ID varies as per the standardized schedule, that is nominal thickness. The same is for all the other sizes till 12 inches, meaning to say that in a pipe less than 14 inches, if it's a pipe of 2 inches or 3 inches or 4 inches or 5 inches or 6 inches or whatever, there is nothing in that pipe which is equal to 6 inch, 4 inch, 5 inch, 3 inch, 2 inch or whatever. The inner diameter is different, the outer diameter is different. This happened because earlier OD was selected from the viewpoint to keep the ID of the pipe close to the nominal pipe size with widely used standard schedule. Standard schedule was widely used as only a small selection of wall thickness were in practice. Thus, OD of 2 inch pipe was selected to be 60.33 mm and standard thickness schedule for it is 3.912 mm. Thus, ID equals to 52.506 mm, which is close to 2 inches, which is again not exactly equal to 2 inches but close to 2 inches. Similarly, for 3 inch pipe, OD equals to 88.9 and the standard available standard thickness at that time was 5.486. Thus, ID became 77.92, which is again close to 3 inches but not exactly equal to 3 inches. Meaning to say that it was tried to bring the ID of the pipe close to that of the nominal pipe size, that is 2 inches or 3 inches or 4 inches, with taking the standard thickness available easily and readily at that time. getting the OD fixed. So OD was fixed in such a manner that when we apply the standard thickness to this OD, we get a pipe size with inner diameter equal to that of the nominal pipe size. But it was only in the case of standard thickness. If the thickness would have been something else, we would have again resulted in various inner diameters. So if the thickness would have been something different from the standard, we would have different pipe diameter, inner diameter, and which would not be equal to that of the nominal pipe size, that is 6 inches, 10 inches or 2 inches, whatever, less than 14 inches. OD the pipe is selected as the base in order to have constant supporting. Why we go for OD instead of ID, that is the flow area of the pipe, flow diameter, is that it is easier for us to support, because for a particular pipe size, say 8 inches, we can have different type of thicknesses as per the thickness requirements, and if we fix the ID, the flow area, then we will have a various types of supporting shoes, various length of the supporting shoes, which needs to be calculated and recalculated every time the shoe calculation or the supporting calculation has to be done. So in order to make that uniform, we fix the OD, outer diameter, as a constant, which is close to the nominal pipe size, and then we vary the inside diameter as per the thickness requirement. From 14 inches onward, OD of the pipe corresponds to the nominal size of the pipe. Now, looking at the figure for the pipe, which is greater than or equal to 14 inches, here again the OD is fixed and the ID varies as per the thickness required, but here the OD is fixed at exactly the 14 inches or 16 inches or 20 inches, the exact nominal pipe size diameter, which is not the case earlier. Later, as the set of available wall thickness evolved, the ID changed and nominal pipe size became only indirectly related to the ID and OD. This happened because earlier OD was selected from the viewpoint to keep the ID of the pipe close to nominal pipe size, with widely used standard schedule, as only a small selection of wall thicknesses were in use, as explained just now. OD of the pipe size is selected as the base in order to have constant supporting. You just seen. So that's final. Thank you.